James Golden Show is on the air with James Golden, a.k.a. Bo's Nerdly.
Welcome, my friends, to Hour Number Trio. It is the Saturday Vibe. You are welcome. Your telephone calls, of course, 800-848-9222 is how you reach us, 800-848-9222. Joining us now, this is a treat. He has become a very dear friend and also an educator for me in the business of polling, and deservedly so. For the last five presidential cycles, his organization has called it right. Not four out of five, not three, five out of the last five. Called it right. He's the person that I turn to when I need to have things explained to me that are going on in the polls. In fact, we did a podcast together, which you can find, Red Apple Podcast. You can find it. And explain to me what a question that I'm going to ask him to explain to you, which is how we should look at national polling and what it means in this election that's coming up very soon. The TIPP poll, Technometrica Institute of Policy and Politics poll, TIPP, headed by Raghavan Mayur, my dear friend. I call him Mayur. Mayur, how are you this morning?
Good morning, sir. Wonderful. I've been up from 3 o'clock working.
Oh, yes. It starts early, especially in these seasons. Myra, thank you for joining us. Let's first go. You have called it right when so many others have not been as accurate. Without getting into anything that would be, private, how have you been able to do this? How have you been able to call each one of these election cycles right?
Well, it's a team effort, you know, and also I'm not that much influenced by partisan politics, if you will, possibly.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't let my biases creep in, knowingly or unknowingly, possibly.
Right. So keep the political biases out of the way. And that goes to the way even questions are framed. So you're very careful, I take, in the way that you frame the questions that you want answers for.
Yeah, it's also, you know, it's when you see a glass half full, you could look at it the glass half empty as well. So it depends on how you know, the same situation or the same data, two people could see it in two different ways. If you live in a newsroom where everybody is a Democratic supporter, you are influenced unconsciously or subconsciously by the environment to see it in a particular way. You get what I mean?
Got it. So let me ask you now, where do we stand? Here we are, weeks before the election. Let's go first talk about where it stands nationally, and then I want to drill down into some of these battleground states.
Yeah.
Overall, where do we stand?
Overall, things have tightened up, okay, nationally. Kamala got a bounce after the convention and stuff. And they were keeping her, with limited appearances and scripted appearances. That bounce has faded away, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, nationally, she leads by 1.8, which means it is very, very, very tight. Okay. The reason being that, just for two things I want to tell you. One is on the same day in 2020, that is today, Biden was leading by 10 points.
Whoa.
In 2016, Clinton was leading by 6 points. And
wait a minute. Let me just get this. I'm taking notes. So yeah. On this same day, we go back. Biden was leading Trump by, you said, 10 points?
Yeah.
And the same day, going back to the Hillary-Trump matchup, Hillary was leading in the national polls by 6 points.
Yeah, exactly.
And today, Kamala is leading in the national polls by 1 point, 6 points, you said, which is within 1. The margin 8. Of error, isn't it?
1.8. Within the margin of error. 1.8.
Which means that that could be either side. That could be what? Plus or minus 3. Maybe exactly. Trump is leading.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Huh? Now, a couple of points I want to mention. This is notwithstanding the fact that typically, if you look at any national poll, as a Republican or the Trump side, you would expect, I would have expected, typically I expect about a lead of 3 points by Harris. Okay. The reason being that Democrats have the advantage in the popular vote from California and New York, which are large states.
Mm-hmm.
So they come to the table with that advantage on the popular vote,
right?
Which is compensated by only Texas. Okay, so mm-hmm. To give you two examples, Hillary Clinton won the popular vote by 3 points, but lost to Trump by about 100,000 votes in the battleground states. And in 2020, Biden won by 4 points in the popular vote, but had Trump managed about 45,000 votes in 3 battleground states, he would have won.
Wow.
So looking at it, it's a very nice position Trump is in right now. Or vice versa, it's not a great position Harris is in.
Which may explain some of the reason that they're panicking. And they sent Obama to try to corral the black male vote, because they're mm-hmm. looking at the margins. And they're looking, if they don't kind of, these same kind of numbers, where 45,000 votes in a few states could make the difference between her winning and losing that state. Is this the reason that they're sending out Obama to try to shore up black male votes and male votes in general?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, you know what? The way I was thinking about it before I came on your show, the key message I have for Republicans is that they shouldn't slack off.
Right.
Okay. They shouldn't become too complacent that they are in a great position right now. It's Trump's to lose. Okay.
Wow.
But the turnout, you know, is really important. And you know, that's even in the betting odds, Trump is up 53.7 to 44.9.
Whoa. Wait a minute. The bettors are... Mm-hmm. Trump is up how much?
53.7 to 44.9.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So
okay.
Everything's changed in the last 10 days, slowly, you know?
What? Whoa. Everything changed in the last 10 days. What are the drivers for that change in the last 10 days?
I think one of the things may be, you know, the hurricanes.
Right.
Yeah, how, you know, people were witnessing how bad the government helped in North Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And the other thing is also, you know, it's so strange. The more people see Kamala, she appeared in several of these interviews, Howard
yes.
Stern, some daddy.
She did the 60 podcast. Minutes piece.
Yes.
She did, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And Telemundo, et cetera.
Yeah. So that's not helping her, you know. That's not moving the needle for her.
So the more people see her, if I'm going to translate this correctly, the more people see her, the more they don't like her. It's kind of what you're saying here.
Basically it doesn't move the needle. So I won't say whether they dislike her, but she doesn't bring enough to move, like what you said. Yeah.
Okay. Got
but,
it.
But that does not necessarily mean they dislike her, but it doesn't move them positively with confidence towards her. Because she doesn't
okay.
come across being authentic. Okay. That's
aha. Uh-huh. She yeah. doesn't come across as being authentic. Mayur, I want you to hold on. I want to go through and walk through what these battleground states are, what they mean when we
okay,
get back.
Sure.
Okay, James Golden, a.k.a. Snurly, with us today, one of the top pollsters in the United States of America. As I've said, this is a difficult feat. For the last five presidential cycles, the TIPP polls have gotten it right. Technometrica Institute of Policy and Politics. And with us, Raghavan Mayur from TIP, explaining where we are in the polling. Oh, yes. 1979. Regata de Blanc comes out. The Police. This is the big hit. Went to number one. Message in a Bottle, 1979, this weekend. James Golden, the Saturday Morning Vibe. Keep it right here.
The James Golden Show. James Golden Show. It's politics, but theater of the mind with James Golden, a.k.a. Bo Snerdly.
He was born in the summer of his 27th year. Coming home.
1997, on this day, music world suffered a big loss. John Denver.
He left yesterday.
Was killed when a handmade experimental plane that he was flying ran out of gas and then crashed. Yes, Carlos.
Handmade.
What? Speak up. Yeah. It was one of these, let's make a plane. Here's the plane kit, let's make a plane. I don't know whether he made it, but he was in it. It was one of the light experimental aircrafts. Yeah, I made the aircraft. Somebody didn't put enough gas in it. Yeah, and Rocky Mountains off the coast of Monterey Bay, California. That was that. 53 years old. John Denver passes away this day, 1997. No fear of flying. James Golden, a.k.a. Snurly, with you here. It is the Saturday Morning Vibe. With me is Raghavan Mayur, who is with TIPP polling. They have been accurate in the last five presidential cycles. Let me talk with you about battleground states. People hear this term all the time, the battleground states. What are they? And how is the election going in those states?
So, as you know, the election will be decided on the basis of electoral votes, not the popular votes.
Right.
So, what happens is that in the battleground states are the states where the race is the closest. For example, California and New York wouldn't be battlegrounds because they are what you call, quote-unquote, blue states, where
right.
Harris will win 60 to Trump 40. Okay? So mm-hmm. in battleground states, the fight is taken to another level, if you will, where it is within 3-4 points, the race, the closest that you can imagine. So there are 7 states in this election, which are the battlegrounds, which will define the outcome. And the 7 states are, within the 7 states, you can group them into 2 categories. One, what quote-unquote, the blue wall states, which are Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania, or also the Rust Belt states. The other group is the Sun Belt states, which are Arizona, Georgia, North Carolina, and Nevada. So these 7 states, they're going to determine the outcome. And within the 7 states, there are, you know, like, for example, if you take Pennsylvania or Wisconsin, there are specific counties which can swing and decide the outcome of that particular state. Now, all these 7 states, they're like, you know, 7 different children, for example. Like, or you can say it's like, they're like your fingers. No, not all of them are same. Okay, each mm-hmm. state has got its each state has got its own personality.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're polling in each of the states, you have to adjust yourself to understand what's going on in the state to some extent. Like for example, Wisconsin is a very great example because typically Trump will overperform than the polls by 5-6 points in Wisconsin.
Mm-hmm.
He has done that in the past 2 election cycles. Okay. So why is that? Because I feel that in Wisconsin, there are more silent Trump supporters than any other battleground state.
There are people in Wisconsin, if I'm hearing this right, who are so intimidated to say, I vote for Trump, they'll just remain silent, won't answer questions, not even to pollsters.
Yeah.
But when it comes to voting, they'll come mm-hmm. out, and that's when they will state their choice. It's Trump, and that's why he overperforms.
Yeah. That's one of the reasons, possibly. Yeah.
Right.
You can attribute for his overperformance. But the same dynamic may not happen, say, for example, in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania, generally, the polls have been good in the past 2 election cycles.
Mm-hmm. And what are the polls showing right now in Pennsylvania?
Let's start with overall first. Among the 7 battleground states, as of today, he is leading 6 of them under a percentage. Yeah.
We have to stop right there for a hard break. I want you to hold on. This is as we go.
Sure.
Of the 7 battleground states, as of today, Trump is leading in 6 of them.
Yeah.
Well, hang on.
On average.
On average. Hang on, mm-hmm. folks. Thriller. James Golden, a.k.a. Snurly, coming back. Your telephone call is going to be part of it, and we're going to wrap it up with Mayur and the election forecast thus far. Stay with us.
James Golden Show. It's politics, but theater of the mind with James Golden, a.k.a. Bose Nerdly.
This weekend, in fact, tomorrow, is the birthday of Paul Simon. Singer-songwriter, part of the duo, of course, Simon and Garfunkel. So many hits with them before he went on solo career. This is one of his big ones from 1986. Paul Simon, happy birthday. You can call me Al. James Golden, you can call me Bo. You can call it 800-848-9222. With Raghavan Mayur. Mayur, let me just ask you this, okay? You said Trump is leading so far, on average, in six of the seven battleground states. Explain what that means to us, please.
Yeah. So, as we were talking in the previous segment, there are seven battleground states, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Michigan, which are the blue wall states, and Arizona, Georgia, North Carolina, and Nevada, which are the Sun Belt states. Now, within the seven states, he is leading in six of them under a point.
Ooh.
Except for Wisconsin, where Harris is leading.
Okay, and Wisconsin is the state that Donald Trump underperforms in, as you also said, usually.
Yes. Yes.
Historically.
So I'm not so worried about Wisconsin because within this margin, he tends to overperform typically. So I'm not really worried about Wisconsin right now. For example, last election cycle, Biden was leading in the final polls in Wisconsin by 6.5 points, but ended up with 0.7. Okay.
Wow. Won the state with less than a point.
Yeah, yeah. From 7 points to that. Okay. And now, if you look at Clinton in 2016, she was leading by 6.5 points. In the final, on average, in Wisconsin. But Trump went on to take Wisconsin with 0.7% margin.
Wow. So that is always a tight state. And it may come down to another one that's underneath a point that decides Wisconsin.
So Wisconsin, if Trump if he continues to perform as good as he did in 2016 and 2020, vis-a-vis in comparison to the polls, he will carry Wisconsin.
Okay. How about Pennsylvania? What are things looking like in Pennsylvania?
Yes. So one of the things that really was very good last week was the change in the tone in Pennsylvania. Okay. That is, Trump, Harris was leading in Pennsylvania, but Trump, there were three polls that showed Trump up in Pennsylvania, including one of ours. Mm-hmm. And that moved Trump in the positive column. In Pennsylvania. Just now I see a New York Times poll that has come out that shows Harris up by 3. And but still, on average, Trump is up by 0.1 point in Pennsylvania, which is the mother of the battleground, if you will. If Trump can take Pennsylvania, the election is over.
Wow.
And I think he has you know, especially given all these assassination attempts and the rallies and everything, and the issues and the non-selection of the governor as the VP candidate and fracking and other stuff, and also the union stuff, plus Joe Biden, you know, Joe Biden had a connection in Pennsylvania. And the Catholics in Pennsylvania, especially the Scranton corridor, I don't think they're so much enchanted by Ms. Harris. So all these things contribute to tightening of the race in Pennsylvania.
North Carolina is interesting to me. Mark Robinson is tanking in that state. There have been some very serious allegations, and I don't know whether he's addressed them to the concerns of the voters there. His poll numbers have tanked, but yet Trump is not tanking in North Carolina. Do you see this as a potential split where we have the presidential candidate could win in North Carolina, yet the Republican on the ticket for governor could lose?
Yes. I think, you know, Trump has won North Carolina both 2016 and 2020, right? And among the polls that I have done in battleground states, North Carolina is one of the states that I have very high conviction that Trump will carry without any problem. But some pundits have been saying recently that the hurricane might have affected the rural areas where there are many Trump voters, and that may lower the turnout of Republicans in the rural counties. But I don't buy that. I think by the time the election is over, they would find some way or the other, you know, to make sure that they cast their vote. Go ahead.
I just want to ask you, because we're running out of time, I just want to ask you one more question, Mayur. Mm-hmm. You said Pennsylvania is the mother of all the battleground states. Trump pulls that off, he wins. Yeah. What's going on with Michigan?
Michigan, again, it's got its own personality. He is, if you look at the Trump-Harris margin among the battleground states, it's the highest in Michigan right now. Trump leads by 9/10 of a point in Michigan. And, you know, there are so many other dynamics that's going on. One is the union thing, as you know, the Teamsters Union.
Right.
Yeah. The second thing is the Israel-Hamas conflict, you know. Many of the Muslims are not very happy with the way Kamala Harris has talked about or handled the Biden administration has handled. And they would, some of them are saying that they're going to vote for Jill Stein, you know, as well.
Ooh. So Jill Stein might actually be a factor in Michigan.
I think she could be a factor in Michigan and Wisconsin, you know. But it's a very, very small thing. But every vote counts, you know. Even if she pulls 20,000 votes, that counts, you know. That is the
and very
dynamic.
Quickly, Arizona is. You said Arizona is still tight. There was a debate.
Half
a point for who?
Trump is leading by half a point. He's leading by
half a point in Arizona.
Half a point in Georgia and half a point in North Carolina. The only state that Harris is leading is in Wisconsin, 3/10 of a point.
No wonder they're starting to panic.
Well, the only
this could
the,
this
know,
could
the
if
panicking.
Trump,
yeah,
the Democrats seem to be panicking, pressing the panic button. I've seen a number of stories about that because of, I guess, the closeness in places like Michigan, Wisconsin, Arizona, and Nevada is, from what I understand, Trump is pretty much looking pretty solid in Nevada. Is that accurate?
He is leading by 0.2 of a point, but you know the thing is
that's
it's
not
so close.
Much.
Yeah. But it's, he's leading. That itself is a good news. The only thing is, all I can say before I leave is that Republicans shouldn't get complacent. You know, they should make sure they turn out pretty good. They've always done the turnout wise good, but. You know, because Trump is leading in 6 of the 7 states, it doesn't mean that, you know, they can slack off. You get what I mean? The turnout is going to
be, this is going to be a tight one. And in one of the cycles, I remember, I'm having trouble remembering which one it was, it went down, the polling changed even during the last 3 days. It tightened up so much. So I'm going to extend an invitation to you right now to give us a reset just when we're just a day or two away, and let's see what your final forecast is, okay?
Yeah, so the final forecast comes out on the morning of the election day, okay?
Then we'll talk. We'll talk that afternoon.
And we can talk before the Sunday, too, you know, to see how things are. Okay?
Great.
Mayur,
thank you so much, and continued success. Hopefully this will be the 6th presidential cycle that you'll nail right down to the number. Appreciate your time so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Raghavan Mayur, my friends, this guy, this is no small feat. 5 presidential cycles, he and his organization have gotten every single one of them right. So I have a lot of confidence in what he says.